mostly new faces today, so this is great. I'm Stephanie Whitney, for those who don't know me. I'm the Director of Research and Innovation Partnerships for the Faculty of Math. And thanks so much for coming to our first student takeover of the Entrepreneurship Impact Series. Before we go into our content, we're going to take a moment to acknowledge that our work takes place on the traditional territory of the neutral Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee peoples. Our main campus is situated on the Haldimand Tract, the land granted to the Six Nations that includes 6 miles on each side of the Grand River. Our active work towards reconciliation takes place across our campuses through research, learning, teaching, and community building, and is centralized within the Office of Indigenous Services. So today we're joined by Jason Amri and Sarah Wilson from 3cycle. 3cycle is a local enterprise working to address 3D printed waste problem by introducing localized circular supply chain for 3D printed waste. Simply, they collect, recycle, and resell 3D printed waste material at the city scale. And you can join them this fall as they launch their pilot in the Kitchener-Waterloo region. Yay! So Jason is the founder of 3cycle, which is a UW-based social venture working to close the loop on 3D printed waste. Currently, he's a fourth year computer science and business student with over a decade of experience with 3D printing. Jason has past experiences in tech strategy and management consulting across startups and large enterprises. He's passionate about finding innovative solutions to address big problems of our world. Sarah is a second year computer science student and the VP of technology for 3cycle. She's a 2022 Schulich Leader and a recent Hack the North finalist. Sarah is passionate about student advocacy, sustainability, and building innovative technology to solve social issues around the world. She finds herself in a variety of hackathons and social events advocating for underrepresented minorities in tech. And so without further ado, I'd like to invite Jason and Sarah up to the front to talk to us about 3cycle.
Thanks, Stephanie. Hopefully you all can hear me okay. I think this printer's for this. But I do appreciate it. As folks trickle in, before we get started, I just want to get a sense of who's in the room with me. I want to keep this pretty casual. Sarah and I will tell you a bit about our work, a bit about the story of 3cycle, and then I want to get to Q&A and hear what you guys have to say sooner. But before we get into any of that, I want to get a sense, who you all are. Who's not an undergrad at Waterloo? Okay, a few people, that's good. So the rest are all undergrads here. Anyone CS? Okay, one CS, because Sarah and I are CS, so I have to ask. Who's used a 3D printer before? Couple hands, okay. I'll tell you a bit more about what 3D printers are and what they look like in the landscape of what we do. And maybe has anyone met Sarah or I or heard about 3cycle before? Few folks. Okay, lovely. So that gives me a good sense of where to start here. Before we get too far into this, I'll talk through these slides. They're just a bit of a pitch. I did a while ago for 3cycle, so you have a sense of what the organization is broadly. But then I want to get into your questions, as I said, and Sarah and I will chat a bit about what our experience has been like as student entrepreneurs. So maybe I'll click through these slides first. So when I first started 3D printing about a decade ago, to me it really felt like magic. The idea that I could imagine something in my mind, design it, and then have it in my hands in a matter of a few hours really blew me away. Over the years, I got to print in my local library, my makerspace, my high school. Eventually, I got my own printer of my own. It's a heavily modified printer, which is my how I kill time over COVID. But as I went through that process, I started to accumulate a lot of plastic waste. It's a really marvelous technology, but I noticed quickly that 3D printing wasn't all that sustainable. You would have test prints, failed prints, support material, rafts, and all of that would end up basically looking like this on my desk. So as anyone would, I started to search online to see if I put the waste in the blue bin, if there's anyone that would want to take it off my hands. But instead, I learned that 3D printing isn't conventionally recyclable. I came across hundreds of articles, Reddit posts, and tweets from people looking for a solution. See, 3D printing is such a rapidly growing industry that by 2030, I think the number I have is 23 full-size Olympic swimming pools. Just given the amount of FDM materials that are produced for 3D printing, our conservative wastage rate, other people put this closer to like 35%, you end up with a ton of plastic waste every year, and there's no way to recycle it at the moment. So the issue is municipal recyclers, it's like a type 7 plastic waste, so they'll redirect it out of their flow, they don't really have the equipment to recycle it, they don't know what to do with it like they might a plastic bottle. Industrial recyclers will sometimes accept PLA material, but only in really large quantities where it actually makes sense for them. So for our smaller scale users, there's not really a solution. And then at-home recycling solutions sort of exist, but they require shredding and then remelting the plastic, so it ends up being pretty expensive in terms of equipment, you need some space for it, it takes a lot of time. So it doesn't make sense for many audiences. So for our stakeholders, the ones we work with primarily, hobbyists like myself, small businesses, and community organizations, there hasn't been a solution that exists for 3D printed waste. And that's where 3cycle comes in. So my name is Sarah, my name is Jason along with Sarah. I'd like to introduce 3cycle, a startup that aims to address this part of the global plastic waste crisis by introducing these localized circular supply chains for 3D printing. We like to use those buzzwords a lot, localized and circular, but what that actually means for us, I want to talk you through it a bit. The current process right now, you make 3D printed waste that ends up in the landfill, but what 3cycle aims to do is we position these collection bins at community organizations like libraries, makerspaces, labs around campus. Individual users can contribute their waste, and the community organizations that print themselves can also collect their waste. That then gets aggregated at a 3cycle location, and then we convert that back to new filament, and with the hopes to eventually sell it back to the community to generate some profit and scale up the initiative. So that's 3cycle. In those years since I've started 3D printing, one thing has remained the same, the amount of unnecessary plastic waste I've seen. So 3cycle is excited to be addressing this problem and to make 3D printing that innovative and sustainable technology we would all wish it could be. So that's my little spiel. I'm happy to share a bit more about my experience here. Maybe Sarah, I'll give you a chance to share a bit about your experience on the team and what you've gotten out of that, and then we can go to the Q&A.
I started experimenting around in 3D printing pretty much in elementary school. My elementary school was in Waterloo, and we were lucky enough to get a 3D printer as well as in high school. So I started playing around there, and the summer after I graduated high school, I had an internship at my school board actually, and they had like over 5 3D printers that weren't being put to use. So basically they're like, as a side project, you just play around with them for fun, you can print out whatever you want, and then I ended up printing out name tags for the entire department, so that was a lot of like playing around and self-learning. Jason reached out to me the summer after I graduated high school and was like, hey, I have an idea, do you want to like join me, and we're going to be a part of Velocity. So yeah, I joined him, like 1A term, just went straight into Velocity. We have a lab over in the Earth Science and Space building.
I don't know if that's ESC, Earth Sciences?
Something like that. But we have a lab on the third floor. Recently, we moved to the second because of construction. But last term especially, I was in the lab a lot working with the engineers in our team. We just take in the plastic, we sort it by hand right now into different colors. We'll shred it down into like sand-like material that can easily be melted with the machinery that we have, and then we'll put it in the machine and it'll kind of like spool out into the spools that you'll see that material, and then we have to kind of like move that towards the other machine that will turn it into an actual spool. So we were playing around with that a lot last term. We do have a few successful spools sitting in our lab, so our product is actually feasible, not just something we brag about. But yeah, that's my experience with 3D printing, and I joined pretty early on with Jason, and I've been really involved in Velocity, not just within 3cycle, but the greater Velocity community, because we receive mentorship from like our lab manager, as well as other startups that work with us in the lab, and over at the incubator in Kitchener. We have a lot of great mentors who at least have provided me, you know, like going to the meetings, they have a lot of business advice that's super valuable. So yeah, I think we're pretty much done with our presentation. We're open to take any questions now about 3cycle, ourselves, as students, and as a business.
Do you want to talk a little bit about your experience with Greenhouse and their social impact incubator, especially the pitch competition? And just even the program, because I don't know that all of the students here would know what that incubator is.
So there was absolutely a time where I didn't know what Greenhouse was at UW. I thought it was actually the Greenhouse outside of SDC. I won't lie. Greenhouse is an incubator in, now they're called United College, I think they used to be St. Paul's. It's an incubator similar to what you might see in some of the Velocity programs, but focused specifically on social impact, on ventures that have an objective not only to generate a profit, but also generate societal good for the world. So I had the opportunity to go through that incubator last summer around the same time I met Sarah. And got to sort of build out the idea and test, as well as eventually pitch and get some of our first funding for the idea. So the program was about the entire semester long. We had all kinds of different sessions, learning how to think about different ideas, how to prototype your ideas, how to actually validate and build a product that people would want, how to pitch for funding, what to do with funding, how to run pilot projects, how to talk to users and do interviews, all kinds of content like that that was really helpful for us as we were getting started to sort of force me to think about these things that I otherwise might not have thought of at that stage. We also continue to get a lot of support from that community, from Tanya and Aaron, who still run the program there. They still connect us with lots of resources, other students who are working on similar startups, and help us get some of those connections to other resources like that. I think for me, one thing that's been really cool about 3cycle is starting to discover all the community of different things that are around us in Waterloo that can support us. Velocity has a lot of programming. I think that's probably what most people know the most about. It has been very helpful for us as well, but that breaks down into a lot of different things. If you dig through the Velocity website, there's tons of resources. Like Sarah said, we're part of Velocity Science specifically, so we get some lab space through there. I've been working a lot in the last few weeks in the Velocity digital space. We've been chatting with Velocity coaches in the last few weeks as well. They have pitches for funding. And then beyond that as well, there's tons of other smaller supports. Folks like Stephanie in the Math Innovation Office have been very helpful for us, especially early as we started to just find other people in the community who were interested in this type of work we were doing. So yeah, I guess that's a bit about Greenhouse, a bit about some of the other things we've seen as well. Majority of hands, I love this. I'll start up here.
So I know that you guys are really busy with school. You guys are just doing major possible working. But as such, you also do recycle. Like, how do you manage time?
Sarah's busier this time than I am. This is on you.
In first year, I was just trying to get involved as much as possible. I came from a pretty involved high school experience. And also because of COVID, I found that I was pretty bored, so I wanted to get involved. So I think it's just because I started off really busy that was the pace that I eventually got used to. It's not like I all of a sudden, you know, added things on after chilling in university. I think things right now are much more chill because I'm on co-op, so much more time to focus on like clubs and activities. But overall, I think it's just like not over worrying about school as you did in high school. Like, you don't need to get those high 90s, it's, unless you're like looking into grad school, but like most people aren't, in CS at least. Yeah, school isn't like, it's not, you don't have to die over school. So I think you should like put time into things that you're generally passionate about outside of school, and just knowing, you know, where your priorities are.
And so how much time do you spend on 3cycle?
3cycle, I would say last term I spent much more time simply because we didn't have the construction going on and I was actually in the lab. I'd say every week 2 to 3 hours-ish. This term much less, simply just can't do much. Because we're kind of like stuck in the closet right now. But yeah, extracurriculars in general, like I'm on a few other clubs as well. So I'm on Math Soc, so like student government policy stuff. I'm on the computer science club as an exec, and we do lots of social and academic events. Those typically take up most of my time. I'd say overall like 2 to 3 hours per week.
I'll just add a quick thing to what Sarah said about, even if you're thinking about grad school, your undergrad grades do not have to be the be-all and end-all. Charlie, just plug your ears right here. I will say, if you spend any time in industry between your undergrad and grad degree, your undergrad grades will matter a lot less. I came out of undergrad engineering with about a 70 average, and I now have a master's and a PhD. So it's possible. Like, you don't have to. Grades don't have to be everything. So
I'd say the other thing is, it's important a lot to realize what's important to you. And like Sarah said, like, for a lot of people in CS, I think it's things often other than like very, very high grades, because those can be very tricky to achieve. And sort of the marginal utility you get out of trying to get like a high 90 versus like a high 80 is, you put in a lot of effort for that, but there's a lot of other opportunities to pursue beyond that as well. I think more practically too, it's nice to have the 3cycle lab on campus, to have our team be all students that are nearby, have a lot of our contributors be here too. It means that most of the work I'm doing for 3cycle is like within the Waterloo campus, and that makes it really easy to do a lot of the work we do. In terms of hours spent, to answer your question as well, it's varied for me a lot between terms. The last two terms I was away for co-ops,
So I wasn't in Waterloo, I wasn't hands-on. This term I'm back, so I'm working on like a shredder and glossy digitalized. It's kind of like hit or miss. I spent like 12 hours on that one day and then nothing for like a week. But it's good to be here because I get to be hands-on with everything, get to know everything so close by.
Jason, to your comment about co-op, one of the questions that we got from the registrants in advance was around co-ops. And the question was, how did you find your first few co-ops impacted or affected your entrepreneurial ideas?
Yeah, I can take my first shot at this, Sarah, if there's anything you want to add. I guess one thing to confess is I haven't done any of my co-ops in like 3D printing or additive manufacturing or anything near the space that this startup is in now. But I did do a lot of them around tech strategy and business strategy work and started to understand what people who build businesses care about. And I think just having that sort of start to click for me was one of the important learnings out of my first co-op. Understanding how to distill down your ideas, communicate effectively. People talk a lot about like soft skills generally, but knowing how to do those things broadly is very important when it starts to become your own business. It's sort of easy to solve problems when they're someone else's business and we have a very tight scope of problems, but the skills you build doing that I've found apply very well when sort of, as a co-founder, every problem's your problem and you have to learn how to do things that are, you're not gonna have experience having done, but you're gonna have the backing of some of the skills, the softer skills you've picked up in previous experiences to help you do well as a co-founder.
I got my first and current co-op from a hackathon, actually. I'm working at Scotiabank in downtown Toronto, and they had a hackathon here in January 2023. It was hosted alongside UW, the Department of Statistics. It was called the Scotiabank Data Science Discovery Days. So yeah, I went to that, joined a random team, was randomly placed with the team because I started solo, and then we ended up winning the whole thing, so that was great. And then I just went throughout the process, and that's how I landed my current job.
Lots of questions on this side, I'll start with
you. So this is a bit more like technical about 3cycle specifically, but do you find that like there's any plastic waste generated just from like melting it down and recreating the spools, and does it degrade the quality of the plastic at all?
Yeah, I guess maybe first I'll clarify your first question. I guess like you're asking more about the yield of the process.
Oh, I did.
Yeah. The second question answers the first question in that case.
Okay.
Yeah, so there's been a lot of research done by other folks into this, less so by us yet, into understanding how many rounds you can actually melt and re-extrude PLA before it starts to degrade. You can notice slight differences after like the first few rounds, but it's only after like 3, 4, 5 like cycles of being recycled that it starts to significantly affect material property. So for us, we collect a ton of virgin materials in. At the moment, we haven't been yet selling back spools to the community. So not any of the material that we collected has been recycled before. But we even anticipate that if we're recycling all this material, we collect new material at a much higher proportion than what we would give back to the community. So we're able to maintain like a ratio where a low enough percentage of the material we're using has been previously recycled by us, that the material properties actually will likely stay very strong. The other thing is, and this was one thing that's been very surprising to me as I've gone through the process, is just needing to understand what people actually care about. So like Sarah was saying, at one point we sorted a lot of our input materials by color. Like my assumption would be, if you're buying filaments, you want like a red filament, a blue filament, whatever, you need like your specific colors. When we talked to some of the people who were interested in purchasing from us, we started to see that they don't actually care about the color specifically because they're buying a recycled filament. They're not expecting as high quality. They're going to use it for their prototyping prints, their test prints, for things that are maybe their own tools or their own workshop stuff, not necessarily a final quality print that they're intending to use long term or give to someone else. We asked about color as well, and what we got is they basically don't care about color. They want something that's like a little more cost effective, but they know is sustainable, so they don't feel as bad if they want to go through a bunch of prototyping cycles with it. Color wasn't a big factor for them. And then in terms of the yield of the process, because we're recycling basically all the plastic we get, it's like theoretically 100% yield. We will try to filter out for a few things. Sometimes people will like write on parts with Sharpie or put like tape or glue on them. Anything like that we try to take out for contamination. So our yield is very much affected by like who our contributors are and their behavior with the parts that they're using. But we find for the most part the like largest contributors we have are giving us like very clean, very consistent parts. And so all of those go back into the process. And once it's into that recycling process, it's like effectively 100%. Hopefully that helps. Cool.
What does your cost structure look like when you kind of have it to begin sustainable? Like, what your costs? How much you agree to sell it to make up for costs? What does it look like?
Yeah, I'm happy to tell you a little about this. Right now, the equipment we use is pretty expensive. That's part of the reason it doesn't make sense for an individual to do a process like this. The machine we use for extruding and spooling is about $5,200 to $5,300. The machine we use for shredding is in the range of, I think, $2,200 to $2,300. So about like $7,000 to $8,000 total for the equipment. Each spool we sell, each 1 kilogram spool, you can get a spool on Amazon for like around $30, usually a bit higher for like some kind of premium spool, usually a bit lower if you're going for a very basic product. We haven't set a target price point yet since we haven't gone to the process of selling. What I've always used in my mind or for my mapping calculations is like a target price point of like $20. So we're going to be like 66% of the price of like an average spool you're going to find on Amazon. We don't know if we launch it, that's actually what we're going to do, so no promises on that, but like $20 a spool, we did the math. I think actually one of the slides is about pilot. So we estimated the amount of waste and water we, for us it's about like 880 kilograms needs to be recovered to make back that initial funding. You might have to check my math on that because we've learned more about the figures as we've gone forward, and this is a bit of an older slide, but we think we need to collect like, say, about a ton of material before we've been able to produce enough to sell enough to make that our original funding. I think even higher. I think we're like 140 something. I picked up a bin today. What's your elementary school?
Our Lady of Lourdes.
Okay, no, it was from Saints A.
Saint Caritha?
No. Yes, that. I was there today. They gave me a good bin, and then CNC also gave us a good bin. So we're probably closer to like 150 now. So we're getting closer to that target as time goes on. But that's generally like the like unit economics of this. For us, we're still thinking about what it looks like from a logistical standpoint to actually collect this material and how we can make that as efficient as possible. What our like sort of network structure looks like for where we want to place like future recycling centers so that the collection distance makes the most sense. Things like that will also affect the cost structure in the long term. But for now, our main focus has been on getting a reliable, scalable process for recycling so that we can start to actually produce spools effectively. And again, it's sort of material testing, selling, and then focus on optimizing the cost structure. Yeah.
As you were just a student who like started this business, did you run into any challenges that you weren't expecting? And do you have any advice for like another student who wants to start a business on how to avoid those challenges?
I guess challenges being a student specifically, or just challenges broadly with starting a startup?
Mainly about being a student, but either or.
I would say I probably got more benefit out of doing this as a student than challenges. Access to a lot of the resources on campus, to spaces on campus, even just being able to send people an email. Like even when I do outreach now, I usually start with like something along the lines of like, hi, I'm Jason, I'm a UW student working on like this problem. The like UW student part kind of gives you some credibility because they know you're learning, they know you're trying something new, they know you're like at a point in your life where you can take that amount of risk. So being a student, I found, just opened many more doors than it's been a challenge in any way. I think the only challenge, honestly, for me is just finding the right way to balance like everything else that's going on in life, as opposed to, say, like a full-time founder where they're like 100% on this business. Those businesses, I think, are able to move much faster than we are, since they're not like ran by people with multiple priorities. But understanding sort of how to make the right amount of time for 3cycle without compromising the other things that are important to me as a student, like say our other extracurriculars, academics, like personal relationships, everything like that has to be balanced well. And as a student, I think there's a lot of factors you have to think about when you make that choice. But honestly, I found a lot more positives of being a student founder than drawbacks like those. And I would say maybe as a word of encouragement for anyone thinking of starting a startup, doing it as a student is one of the best times to do it. You're like, how far you can fall if you fail is very short. If you start a startup, it's a good idea, you think it's a good idea, you build it out, you start a team, whatever, and it all implodes in a year, you just keep doing your studies. Like, you'll graduate a couple years with a degree, you can do the same thing everyone else in your class is doing, versus doing it once you're full-time, once you have a career. I'm nowhere near this, but once you have a family and a mortgage and all of that, it's much harder to take those risks. And you are much further away from the extensive resources we have on campus to support some of these initiatives. So if you have an idea in mind, I'm a big proponent of taking that risk now and starting to pursue your idea when you have a very strong safety net and access to a lot of resources. I don't know if that really answered your question, but there's not too many challenges in my opinion.
I think I could add on to this, like for 3cycle specifically, we're very much community-based, right? So we rely on people providing us donations. We can't just magically, you know, come out with it ourselves. And so that was like finding the right sort of connections, and being students, we can talk to labs on campus. I grew up in Waterloo, so it's reaching out to like my elementary school, my high school, and just people within the school boards. So in terms of that, I think it would be harder if you didn't have that network around you, but being students, we bring on more students onto our team. We have students over in Laurier, we have people helping us from Windsor and York. So having that student community and those like connections is also really important.
Yeah. This might be a little bit too broad for me to ask, but what's your philosophy on teamwork? And how do you balance between doing things independently and delegating tasks to other members on your team?
That's a good question. You're on my team. How do you feel this goes?
I think our team is pretty chill. Like, we're all very supportive. If someone's busy, we'll just take on someone else's work. Because we don't have very, you know, defined responsibilities. But of course, in general, we do. But overall, we're such a small team that we are able to like help each other out. And for example, like if it's something technical, then myself and the engineers will work on it. We're not going to get the business students to work on it. But even then, we still have like two or three people that are very knowledgeable in this field, and we can all just help each other out. So yeah, it doesn't feel like a very strict chain of command where we're ordering people. Even like established clubs here on campus, you'll have some sort of hierarchy, right? Like a president and whatnot. It's a little bit more formal then, but I think in a startup, your like job responsibility is very much self-defined. It's whatever you feel contributing to your team. And that's why when we hire people, it's we want people who are generally very passionate, not just people who are like sitting there waiting for you to give them a task, right?
Yeah, I'll pick up on that last point very well. When we bring people onto the team, I'm looking for people that have a skill set that's important to us and are passionate about this. And someone was asking me about this recently, if there's someone we were thinking about bringing onto the team, wondering like what kind of qualifications we look for, exactly what the role is going to look like. The way we look at it is very hard to answer questions like that. Because like I said, I want to bring out someone who has skills that are important to us and passion, and basically let them run with what they want to run. So we'll sort of show them the problems we've solved within the business and the problems that are still there. We have a long list of like things we want to do and which terms we want to try and achieve these things. And we sort of give that list and say some of these might make sense for your skill set. Like run with them, see what you can progress. And we've gotten really cool things out of that. I think of like Sarah, you were running like a newsletter campaign, which was like super cool. Like the idea out of that is, or the problem space out of that is we need better relationships with our contributors on an ongoing basis when we're not doing maybe pickups as often. And like Sarah had a really cool skill set and was able to actually work towards that goal very effectively for us. To your question of when do we start to bring questions to the broader team, my personal philosophy is like as soon as I stop feeling like I have the answers, that's when I go to the rest of the team. So we're chatting a bit about this now around sort of what the future of 3cycle looks like. Once I graduate, once my co-founders start to work as well, what could our organization structure look like to actually continue to succeed in the long term? And that's something I have some ideas on, but I have very few answers on. So it's become sort of a team-wide question, like an all hands on deck to start to dig into some of these and understand what it looks like in the future of our organization.
So in other words, it's really important to adapt to unpredictability and to be able to define a solution to a problem that may not even be super apparent yet.
Exactly. And the fact that we're in a pretty niche field, like we didn't have very outstanding competitors or like other people that we could follow. So it was really just defining the problem ourselves, defining the solution ourselves. And with that comes a lot of fun, honestly. Like, you get to put your ideas into production, and you have a lot of creativity in startups.
Perfect, thank you.
I'm going to take this slide off so this doesn't blind me, and I can actually like walk around and be closer to you guys, because otherwise this would like blind me.
Catching on what Sarah just said, who are your main competitors, especially commercial competitors? Perhaps your future buyers?
Yeah. To Sarah's point, there's not a ton of competitors out there doing this. There's been other like small ventures that have tried to look at ways to solve this recycling challenge. A bit of what we do when it comes to some of those buzzwords is this like circular localized model. So other people have attempted to solve this problem by offering, for example, service for PLA collections. The challenge then is they usually charge their contributors a fee, and we found that that's ends up being a substantial barrier to getting contributions from a lot of people. So we do it on like a no-fee basis, and we instead generate the like economic profit from being able to sell back the filament. Whereas other or like other attempts at this have just tried to like aggregate all that waste and give it to an industrial recycler, where they don't actually capture sort of that full economic profit.
And that's as well. Must you create additional like 3D printable filament, or can you do something else with your products?
Our main idea right now is to just create a new 3D printed filament, in particular because putting PLA plastic into a usable form like that increases its value a little bit, like as opposed to selling it as a raw material, for example. If you're able to get through that conversion processing and back to filament, you get a higher value end product. And the cool thing about our model is we're actually able to sell back to the contributors we collect material from. So we have a very close relationship with these people visiting their space often, you know, for some of them emailing them quite often to understand like when the pickups are going to be, what their needs are. Often a very casual relationship, but we have relationships with as many stakeholders in the community that 3D prints as possible. And then once we actually get to wanting to sell our spools, we have people there that we know that are eager to start to buy these back, as opposed to any other format of the material. Yeah.
So you mentioned that like there have been a few ventures like related to this that, well, you didn't mention that they're still around, so presumably they've all, you know, gone away. So what sort of challenges do you expect to face if you try to like increase the scale of this, or just in the future when you launch this on like a city scale?
I'll let you add to this as well. My first thought that comes to mind for that, and one thing we're still sorting through, is just understanding how the logistics of the collection actually works. That's something we've iterated on consistently as we've gone through like our stages in the last year. I should update our website. I think we said the fall pilot was fall. I think that's last fall. So we have had a chance to learn a little bit from it as we go through. And in that process, we've like sort of optimized how we manage the schedule, the pickups we do, but we're continuing to try to understand how to make it as easy as possible to get the waste from a 3D printer, from beside a 3D printer, like in a library, or today I went to elementary school, like in Kitchener, to a lab space where it can actually start to be recycled and then packaged and sold back. So that actual like logistics chain for us, so that is very important to be, I can like a problem we want to continue to work on for scale. It's also important to us to understand how that plays in with the community broadly. So putting our equipment in places where people with 3D print are, so that they can easily start to recycle their material, is one thing we're looking at, for example. I think that's probably one of the biggest challenges we're continuing to face. The other one, as I mentioned, is less of a challenge of the idea, more of a challenge of our circumstance, which is this is my like last term on campus. I'll be on exchange in the winter and then graduating and starting work. My co-founder starting work in the new year. So for us, we're trying to figure out what the future of this organization looks like, whether it continues to be student run or branches out into something that's more community-based and can center around other organizations that have ties to this sort of work. For us, that's another like specific big problem we're working on.
Yeah, I would say another challenge is like not really knowing what you're doing sometimes, because like I'm a computer science student, I learned software in school. I don't know anything about hardware really, unless I, you know, take an elective or something. And so learning all that, I guess, on our own, especially last term, because we were in the lab experimenting, there's a lot of YouTubing, there's a lot of like asking other years. We were working with engineering capstone teams, so they were great mentors when we needed them. And yeah, finding those resources on your own can be pretty difficult when you're not like handheld, I guess. But that's, just like a people problem that you eventually have to get through.
I think that's a good point. I think a lot of startups, or just being in a startup, you face a lot of uncertainty with what you're doing. So being able to sort of push through that uncertainty and still try and take risks, even if you have no idea if what you're doing is the right model. I like to remind the team, and I like to say this broadly, that the reason we're doing things the way we are today is because we think this is the best model to solve the 3D printed waste problem. And if someone comes tomorrow and says, I have a better idea for how you approach this, it has nothing to do with pickups and recycling, it is, I don't know, something left field you haven't thought about, we would actually start to consider that and move forward to that. Because we have a like, key idea of what our mission is, and our decisions are basically what is going to be best towards achieving that mission. So when we're not sure what decision to take, we sort of look at that as our like North Star, and sort of take the next step we think is best. Sometimes we learn, sometimes we take a step backwards before we take a step forward again to sort of understand what works best for an organization like us working towards that specific objective. So dealing with a lot of uncertainty I think is natural to startups, but like Sarah said, it's a challenge of ours as well.
Do you plan to continue with 3cycle full-time when you graduate, or part-time, another job?
Yeah, the short answer is for me and my co-founder, unfortunately, not much. We're both going into like relatively intensive roles in management consulting, so we know our attention is going to be in other places. Physically, we're going to be in other cities as well. So being able to support 3cycle in the ways I've been able to so far will be challenging if feasible at all. We are talking about this as sort of like very, very new conversations for us, but we're talking about this as well. I think I do want to continue to have a bit of a role as an advisor, sort of see how the project continues to progress. But the short answer is, for me, I don't think it'll be something I'll be able to take on full time.
Yeah, I'm at 2B right now. I still have a few more years, so like I'll be here. And that's why when we're looking into hiring, like we're not, you know, looking for like people who are just going to graduate in one term. Because still, like, in order to stay in Velocity, I guess you still need a student status. You have to go through like the safety training to be able to get into the physical lab. And so, yeah, I think we're trying to bring on some younger people, like first year, second years, that can hopefully stay with us for longer.
Do you have a question? You had your hand up a few times.
Yeah. So you mentioned incubators in Kitchener. Would you like to share more about that?
Yeah, I mentioned that. I can talk more about that. So in Velocity, we're a part of Velocity Science. You might have heard of Velocity Health, which is one of the newer branches. But basically, we have mentorship from people within Waterloo and then people over at the incubator in Kitchener. So in the kind of Communitech tech bubble over there, there are people who are pursuing their startups full time. And so sometimes we have these like weekly roundtable or bi-weekly roundtables with all of the startups in our current lab. And then sometimes we have the meetings over there. So then we get like mentorship and people come in and they'll give like a 15-minute lecture and like, here's how to run a business in this industry. And they'll talk about their specific industries. So it's sort of that like mentorship of talking to people who might also be UW alumni, who might also have gone through like the undergraduate process and then into full time. So it's not like very, you know, mentorship like, oh, once a week we're gonna meet. It's just like whenever Velocity can provide something, we'll just show up and meet people, and it's great for networking as well.
Under Velocity.
Yeah, it's fully under Velocity in terms of like the incubator, yeah.
Yeah. So I wanted to ask, like, particularly in the early stage of starting a business, like, how should I manage, like, how do you guys manage the funding and all the equipment issues, like, in the very early stage of the business?
Yeah, so you mentioned, like, funding. What do you mean in terms of equipment?
So basically, like the equipment that you need, like to start your business, like recycling the 3D printed materials, because you mentioned like after like, you got like a lot of crew members in your team, and then you got like more connections. But I mean, like in the early stage, you don't got that much resource like you did right now. So I'm just wondering like how you get those supports in the early stage.
Yeah, that's a good question. My answer is a little blunt, which is sort of that it's free to pitch and free to do pitch competitions. Think about your idea, bring it as far as you can with spending as close to $0 as you can as possible, and then pitch that idea. Put together slides, put together something like this, maybe something better than this, and put it together into something you can do in a 5-minute Velocity pitch, in a greenhouse pitch. We did the problem pitch. Each of those sessions, you're gonna go through mentorship, you're gonna get feedback from judges. If your idea is something that resonates with them, you're also going to get funding, and that can help you move the idea one step forward. For us, like we've continued to fill out other grants on campus to develop this idea, but really the like unlocking that like first funding for us was just about building out an idea conceptually as far as we can without anything physical that costs us any money, pitching that idea, finding people who, learning from the pitches firstly, but then also finding people who are supportive of the idea as it developed and getting funding from that to move forward.
How much did you win from
the pitch? 2K. We were semi-finalists from the Quantum Valley Investment Problem Pitch Competition, then 5.5 at Greenhouse, and then we got, I think, 9.2 from the Sustainability Action Fund on campus from the Sustainability Office, and 5 from a similar fund in Oregon.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, and the Velocity Lab itself, I don't even know what the number is, but like having that space to do stuff, we don't pay rent, we don't pay electricity or anything, that's like much more valuable than, you know,
any number. Sorting space from computer science here through faculty, so.
Yeah. To hold like 100 kilograms of plastic in place, like Velocity has that place for us.
How did you spread the word about 3cycle? Because you said it is a pretty niche field, so like, how did you get the attention from like people who had maybe no idea about 3D printing and it's like, it's effects?
Short answer is this, doing things like this, just talking about the idea, talking to people who are interested to hear more about it. I remember like when I was just starting before there was like Sarah, before some of these pitches even, I was just like sending like emails being like, like, this is me, this is my background. I'm starting to work on a problem in this space. I know you guys have some 3D printers. What are you doing around your waste management? Now, can we chat to learn a bit more? I like to joke, a lot of those emails went unanswered, and then like months later, the same person would like reach out to us asking about 3cycle because they heard from someone who heard from someone. But just starting to reach out to the community in any ways you can, and then once the idea gets any traction, starting to talk more about it with that new opportunity you get.
Yeah, before I started focusing on the technology side of 3cycle, I was actually doing a lot of marketing. Just because I grew up in Waterloo, like having my elementary teachers spread around the news got us a lot of other interested schools who were interested in donating. We like the newsletter, like Jason said, that helped. And I attended a few hackathons on behalf of 3cycle, so I was invited to judge some like high school level hackathons. Or there was also a hackathon of Turtle Hacks, which is fully environmentalism related, and I was like literally looking at 3D printing stuff. So yeah, spreading the word through hackathons has been really fun just because I personally enjoy that a lot.
Yep. So I'm actually not a University of Waterloo computer science student, but my close family members worked here for over 20 years, so I kind of put the campus here. This is a little bit of a long question, so bear with me. I've had experience running a conference from start to finish, going from like an idea on a board to like a full-blown event where you invite multiple people, and I did this on York University campus, and it was called Explore Science. And my question for you is, how do you deal with logistical problems? How do you deal with issues that may appear, whether it's miscommunication between different team members, and what's your overall strategy when dealing with several different parties?
I'm going to give an equally long answer to a long question. I don't remember where this comes from, but it's an interesting lesson I learned. The difference between how you think about a car accident versus a plane crash. When there's a car accident, you like, I don't know, a car collides with something, you pick up the pieces, you make sure everyone's safe, you make sure the driver's better trained next time, but then you put the same cars back on the road, you drive on the same roads again. When there's an aircraft accident, it gets torn apart from an engineering perspective. You want to understand everything that went wrong, you build checklists, you understand like the psychology of the pilot, you go through everything in detail, but you don't just fly the same plane again under the same processes. You come up with new processes, new guides, new checklists, new training, new equipment to make sure you don't run into that challenge again. So one thing that's been important to me as a startup founder is one, understanding what's a car crash and what's a plane crash. What do we need to just fix once and run it again and it'll be fine, versus what do we actually need to do a proper root cause analysis of and fix and improve. Making more things plane crashes than car crashes is very important to me. Building systems that help us improve the way we do everything we do, whether it's an actual challenge or whether it's just something that's slower than it needs to be or less efficient than it could be. Being able to continually improve what we're doing and like re-engineer the processes we have, thinking about the challenges we have in the organization to actually make them better instead of just addressing them locally, make them better like broadly as like a process point. That's how we sort of get better and more robust over time. For me, I guess two recent examples come to mind. One is with our pickup process. When it started, we had a QR code on the boxes that just went to our email address, and people could just send us an email and say, hey, we're ready for a pickup. That was great at first, that was a great like first plan to launch. But then we got a ton of emails, it's hard to manage the inbox among other stuff, all kinds of other challenges that came with it, or more just inefficiencies. Now with the new labels on our bins, you scan a QR code, you get a form, the form sends, puts it into Monday database, the Monday database sends a notification to Slack, so everyone whoever the operations lead is sees that notification and can send it to the right channel depending on the region it's for. They can find people for pickups, there's automated reminders, it's scheduled back again through Monday. Monday sends emails back to the contributors, so there's visibility. It's like this whole end-to-end process. What used to be like emails that would get lost is now this like fully automated, documented way that we approach a consistent like flow within our business. Another example is just with our equipment. We were using, before we had the protocycler, which was the one that was in the photo here, we were using like more cost-effective, that's a kind of way of saying just like cheaper equipment, which was good, it was effective, but it was a little tricky to use. So for us, getting equipment that costs twice as much but gives us better throughput, a better outcome, and is just more efficient to use for our team is important to us. Because we know when we want to reach scale, those factors are going to matter a lot, and we'll spend a little bit more now to be able to get equipment that's actually going to address this, as opposed to trying to fix the specific issue we're having with the like less, like the cheaper equipment. It's like, you look at it at some point to decide like this is a plane crash problem for our business, we need to take a big leap forward and we're going to invest in something that's going to make a difference for our business. That might have strayed a bit from your question, but how do we actually look at challenges?
Not at all. So pretty much what you're saying is that you're able to classify the problem that you're issuing into two different categories, and based on that category, you're able to have an appropriate response. And that way it actually saves you thinking power, because then you don't over-rationalize or overthink about a specific issue.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I think the only other thing I would highlight is sometimes you solve the problem that's in front of you, sometimes you solve that entire thing with something completely new, because you realize like what you're looking at, it's not just a small problem,
yeah,
it's a bigger
problem. Yeah.
And for context, our first shredder was a coffee grinder. Yeah. So we've upgraded since then. Any other questions?
Yeah.
So last, the father of the business, how to determine who is the proper person to be included in your project, and Sarah, what attracts you to join the startup?
Do you want to go first?
Yeah, so I was straight out of high school, right? And I didn't know what Velocity was. Frankly, I didn't know any UW clubs, despite growing up like living right beside campus. So it was really just Jason coming up to me and being like, I have an idea, do you want to join? And yeah, it's been like through that really. And I think just networking and finding people who are also interested in similar problems can help lead you to, you know, big things.
Yeah, I think I touched on this a bit earlier, but for me, I look for relevant skills and passion. I don't necessarily look for qualifications on paper. I don't necessarily look for specific experiences they have or many of those other, like, I don't know, common criteria. I'm looking for someone to bring, I look for anyone to bring on the team who's sort of understands the problem, is passionate about it, and who has skills that could help with some of the things we want to work on. And then bring them into the organization, sort of let them run with it. There's been like a handful of people we brought onto the team who have come in, who have met those criteria, come in, realize this isn't for them, but they're not for us, and that, you know, maybe there's not enough problems for them to work on that excite them, maybe the problems we have are different than what they thought they were, and there wasn't that alignment, and then we part ways. There's not too much risk with bringing someone new onto the team, but I find you get the best people if you get people that are going to be able to do things or are going to want to do things.
We'll take one more question before we transition to the networking includes here.
You've got our favorite part. Anyone want to take the risk and ask the last question? Yeah.
You mentioned that you would be like moving on from this like a startup. So what's like the transition process like? Why not? Like, I mean, if you don't want to take this on, I mean, for the second.
Yeah. This is going to be a short last question. The answer is we don't know. I was chatting with my co-founder about this last week and the week before. I'm going to chat with them this week and next week, and we're still working on this. We're still trying to figure out what our plan is. I think we have options A all the way to H right now. That list will probably grow longer. We're going to do pros and cons. We're going to put decision criteria. We're going to weigh them all and try and evaluate this as what the future of our organization could look like. The short answer is we don't know yet, but I'm excited to see.
All right. Thanks so much, Jason.
Thank you.